Welcome to Politics Done Right. I am your host, Egberto Williams. This is the progressive program that will take the mystery out of politics. This is the program that will encourage you to make sure government becomes we the people. Whether you are liberal, conservative, or otherwise, you get to air your point of view. Remember, you can also send me a tweet to EGBERTOWILLIES. That is, at Egberto Williams. Let us engage. It is politics done right.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, folks, welcome to one more edition of Politics Done Right. I'm Egberto Willis, your host. Thank you so kindly for spending this 1 hour with me on a Saturday afternoon, right afternoon. We're going to talk about Donald Trump and this new war with Syria, or war on Syria, or whatever you want to call it. I mean, it is frustrating to watch the media and their current reaction to Donald Trump becoming presidential now that he has sent 59 missiles into Syria. Now, I want to ask you guys one specific question. Why is it that war makes someone presidential when the suffering of millions of people over the years, over his few months in office, did very little to support them? How is he looking presidential now when he denied the same people that he claims to care about and he's claiming to defend by sending these missiles somehow presidential when he's attempting to inflict damage? And by the way, the people who landed or threw out the sarin gas or whatever it is that they used there, I'm sure they weren't at that airbase, yet it was the airbase that got targeted. So if there are folks who died at the airbase, it is likely that they had nothing to do with what occurred in Syria when these people killed innocent children. So let's be clear here. Let's really be clear. There is nothing, there is absolutely nothing presidential about sending bombs into some other country because they've done wrong or whatever else. That's not what defines presidential. Now, it's interesting, and before I get into the topic, I want to just put a little thing over the top here. Remember that during that time when Syria, again, used some sort of a poison gas, and Obama drew a line and said, if they did something again, I guess the United States would act. And in effect, the president didn't act when they issued, President Obama, that is, didn't act when they put out sarin gas. A lot of people complained and said, he was weak, he was unpresidential, and all the other things that you hear placed on President Obama when he doesn't act the way somehow the right believes he should act. What is interesting is, yes, President Obama put out a red line. He didn't cross it. What the mistake the president made is he should have drawn no red line. But it's honorable. It is honorable to know that if you draw a red line, and you know death would be inflicted unscrupulously, that you won't go ahead and do it just because you don't go kill people just because you said there would have been consequences if somebody draws the line. That is simply inhumane. And I think, in as much as we have other problems with the president and drones and killing a lot of folks because of collateral damage when they're trying to take out some terrorists or whatever, in this case on Syria, he made the right choice. In the case with Donald Trump, he just shot from the hip. But did he? Did he really shoot from the hip? Or is this all planned? Or is this all orchestrated? I tell you what, I'm not the one that goes or believes in conspiracy theories. I don't like it, just like I don't like it on the right. I don't like it on the left. But if something smells as bad as this smells, one ought to consider, as Lawrence O'Donnell did last night, one has to consider what are the benefits of launching an attack that accomplished absolutely nothing other than saying, I would use a bomb. Think about that. The base was operational immediately after the attack. We ensured that we informed the people of the attack so that nobody supposedly would get hurt in the attack. We didn't target a whole lot of planes that would have destroyed an Air Force that supposedly landed these gases. So what did we accomplish with an attack? We heard a muted response from Russia, and you also got a semi-muted response from Syria. Think about that. Why weren't these guys jumping and screaming and talking about retaliation if this wasn't some sort of a, whether it is an organized orchestration or simply a, I know what you want me to do, I know what your reaction is supposed to be, and I will appease that. I know that you are in trouble right now. I know that you are in trouble right now with your people in America. Okay, do your thing. Do your thing. So think about that. Think about that. Anyway, what is our show going to be today? Our the title of the show today is kind of interesting. I mean, I called it conspiracy theory. Is Trump Syria missile attack a Putin Trump ruse? I don't know. I don't know. But I think it's good, or there's much that can be inferred. Trump sent 29 Tomahawk cruise missiles to an airbase in Syria, and the base remained operational. Russia shows tremendous restraint in their response to the strike. The mainstream media now, once again, act as if this earns Trump a presidential medal. Republican and Democratic neocons alike praise Trump. Some even refer to him as Ronald Reagan-like. Wow, I support that characterization, though. I think Trump's actions were Ronald Reagan-like, but in a negative way, of course. Because those who praise Ronald Reagan as being the best thing since apple pie, this great president that did great things, I am sorry. That's not the Ronald Reagan I know. That is not the Ronald Reagan that economic theory tells you he is. That is not the Ronald Reagan that war theory tells you he is. Ronald Reagan was a puppet of the neocons. Ronald Reagan was a, like most presidents, again, I have to admit this, was a ward of the military-industrial complex. But worse, Ronald Reagan had no heart in the structures that he set up that we are still living with. It is deeper than trickle-down economics, but what it has done is decimated the middle class, it has decimated the poor, and it has transferred the wealth of most or large portions of Americans right up the ladder. So yes, if they want to call Donald Trump the next Ronald Reagan, I'll give them that. I will give them, yes, Donald Trump is the next Ronald Reagan. And let's look at the results that we're still living with decades after Ronald Reagan. So again, I will cop to that. Yes, he is the next Ronald Reagan. But folks, I think you know what time it is. And it is an important time.
It's time for the weekly blog post.
Okay, and here it goes. The weekly blog post I wrote a couple of days ago. And it's called, and actually I wrote this before Lawrence O'Donnell came out with the piece that he did last night. I blogged that piece that Lawrence O'Donnell did last night, placed it on Daily Coast. And it was actually, I think it's, let me see if it's, it may still be the most recommended on Daily Coast right now. But it was all morning, it was the most recommended, it's still the most recommended article on Daily Coast, a little piece that I wrote on what Lawrence O'Donnell did. So check it out at dailycoast.com. But I wrote this one here. I wrote this one here a couple of days ago, right after the attack, I believe, the day after the attack. And it goes as follows. The title is, Once Again, Americans Played by Trump and Media Eating It Up. Here it goes. It is deja vu all over again. Another Muslim country, this time Syria. The president goes to war virtually unilaterally. The media sings glory, glory, hallelujah. And politicians, Democrats and Republicans alike, praise the president, followed by a poll bump. Well, it is still too early to confirm the poll bump, but we'll see. I am almost certain he's going to get a pretty darn good bump in the poll for doing this. Again, Americans, we really have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do. And those of you who are listening to this show right now, remember to share it. And not only share it, remember to talk about it. Remember to talk about the issues we discuss here, because a lot of our friends and neighbors and families, they do need to hear this type of information. Why? Because the mainstream media, if you look at how the mainstream media is really going overboard about supporting what Trump has done and making it look at as if he has done something great, something presidential, something that is worth doing. They're so gullible. This is a media that is supposed to keep us informed. We can't blame our friends and families and neighbors when they believe what they hear on TV, you know, when they vote for a Trump, when they vote against your own interests, when the media, the fourth estate that is supposed to be keeping us informed, is so gullible, is so easily turned, they so easily change a narrative. They're simply played like a piano. They're played like an harp. Think about it. With this one move, Trump has spent 80-something million dollars, whatever it is, 59 Tomahawk missiles cost and the other expenses. All he needed to do is spend about $100 million of your taxpayer dollar to change the narrative for several days. Wow, the power of the executive, the power of the presidency. And we eat it all up. We shouldn't be eating this up. We should be screaming. We should be on Facebook. We should be calling radio stations. We should be writing op-eds. We should be doing all of these things at once, condemning what has occurred here. Because the reality is, whether it is a ruse or not, what he did was wrong, it was illegal, it served no purpose. But continuing the blog post, Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria, is a very evil person. He kills his own people, but so does dictators or leaders throughout the world. Syria is in the news every day. Friendly governments and not so friendly governments to the United States, who do the same thing without mainstream media coverage, are not. An example, Russia, the Philippines, Turkey, Nigeria. All these countries have their sect and governments that really kill their people, really do bad things to people. But we never hear about it. It's never reported on TV. It's never reported hardly in the New York Times or elsewhere. But it's reported in foreign papers. And people around the world knows about it. So when we talk about we're defending these young kids who are just gassed, yes, I'm very sorry they were gassed. But the reactions that we had is not proportionate to the reactions we have to in other parts of the world. That is what we're talking about here. But anyhow, there's a civil war in Syria. There are many armed factions, including many that are anathema to American values, which should give us pause. In other words, we can go in there and fight, but who are we fighting for, or who are we fighting with? There are so many factions, some aligned with Hezbollah, some aligned with Al-Qaeda, some aligned with the right of the government, some aligned with the left of the government. In the post that I blog of the week, I include a link to all the different factions in this war that is worth looking at. But anyhow, why would any American president get involved in a situation in which the instability makes accurate information at best, suspect. Why would they do that? Anyhow, as recent as a week ago, it was Trump's policy to leave Syria alone. CNN reported as follows. The Trump administration doubled down Thursday on, and not this Thursday, the previous Thursday, doubled down Thursday on prioritizing the fight against ISIS over ending the Syrian civil war and getting rid of its main protagonist, President Bashar al-Assad, a suggestion that was swiftly criticized by hawks on the Hill. Indicating a possible shift in U.S. policy on the war in Syria from the days of the Obama administration, Secretary of State Rex Tillerson said on a trip to Turkey that the, quote, longer-term status of President Assad will be decided by the Syrian people. That was the policy of Trump, the policy of the United States government under Trump a week ago. It's none of our business. The Syrian people, they have to resolve these issues themselves. And in New York, U.S. Ambassador to the UN Nikki Haley was even stronger about Trump administration's decision not to push for Assad's departure. Our priority is no longer to sit and focus on getting Assad out. That was the policy. Haley told wire reporters Thursday, according to AFP. That's not this Thursday, the Thursday before. Do we think he's a hindrance? Yes, she said. Are we going to sit there and focus on getting him out? No. That was policy a week before the bombs. It is hard to believe that both Putin and Assad didn't get the message. It is harder to believe that Assad would then force President Trump's masters, the military-industrial complex, to force him into some kind of an act. We cannot and must not believe the reports our mainstream media is giving us. It is not logical. The only thing we know is that we do not know. Again, the only thing we know is that we do not know. We do know that Trump is in bed with the Russians based on empirical evidence. We do know that military-industrial complex, along with its puppets in both parties, are biased to using our vast military resources and keeping the industry flushed with our tax dollars, even as programs beneficial to us all are left wanting. So, ask yourself some very simple questions. Again, conspiracy? Maybe, but ask yourself these questions. It is clear Assad was not a target of the Trump administration, granted. Why do something that would have low information Americans and neocons force the president to act? Again, why would they do something to force us to act? It makes no sense. They could continue doing what they were doing without doing something that would trigger Americans. Is it not likely that the chemical weapons were used by the opposition to force U.S. action? Would the opposition maybe even cloaked in the vestiges of the Syrian government try to poison their own people in order to, given that the United States decided that, oh, they're washing their hands off of doing anything in Syria, so we have to make it look like Bashar al-Assad is doing something really bad to force the United States into action. You know, I mean, what else could the reason be by just saying, you know, if the United States not going to go, why would the Syrian government try to do something that they know would get us in? They know would get media coverage, or just as well. Could this be an Assad, and this is what I'm saying now, or just as well, could this be an Assad-Putin-Trump pact to force a U.S. action that gives a semblance of a rift, Trump and Putin, between Trump and Putin? In other words, I'm just putting questions out there. One, it could be that the opposition are the ones who unleashed this gas. That's a possibility. But it could also be that Assad unleashed this gas on the behest of Vladimir Putin. Why? Because, well, Donald Trump needs help. Everybody think he's a Russian stooge. If he goes ahead and attack Russia's own stooge, then what happens? Ah, the media exactly starts to fall for what they're doing right now. Oh, we gotta think about it now. If Trump is attacking Syria and Russia is in Syria, maybe, just maybe, he's not really a Russian stooge. And they bought it. The media bought it. And I don't, look, I'm gonna tell you, the media got a whole lot. The media got a whole lot out of, rather, Trump got a whole lot out of this. It costed him over $80 million, over $100 million likely to get it, but he got it in the short term. An expensive U.S. attack that destroyed nothing. An expensive U.S. attack that destroyed nothing of substantial value. Runways, air defense, etc. is probative, folk. It is clear that Trump likely established communication back channels with Putin. We know that was done. But, again, conspiracy theory? Could be. Reality? Could be. Will we ever know? Maybe. But I tell you what, it smells pretty damn stink. I think it smells pretty darn foul. Anyhow, establishment Democrats and establishment Republicans agree on very little. The one thing they always seem to agree on is stuffing the coffers of the military-industrial complex. And the media, just like the run-up to Iraq, are simply singing the tune of the warmongering plutocrats without doing any logical examination of what is likely occurring. Let me repeat that. The media, just like the run-up to Iraq, are simply singing the tune of the warmongering plutocrats without doing any logical examination of what is likely occurring. Folks, I have no, and I just want folks to expand their thought process. And I'm straight whenever I tell stories, whenever I'm talking about issues, I try to stay with facts. This one here, I cannot. Why? Because we don't know the structure here. We are factless. We have an administration that we know is a lying administration. We have a CIA and an FBI who are bound by certain rules of engagement and certain rules on which they can say and not say. We have within the FBI folks that we know are partial to Donald Trump. And we know we have neocons who would do just about anything to go to war. If you ever doubt why Lindsey Graham decided to call Donald Trump the next Ronald Reagan, or not the next Ronald Reagan, but Ronald Reagan-like, it is because he wanted to appease Donald Trump. Donald Trump showed that he would use weapons. Lindsey Graham and all the neocons thought that because he ran as a populist nationalist, that he wouldn't want to engage in other countries and engage the United States military elsewhere other than just building it up. Well, Donald Trump gave them a gift. He gave the neocons a gift. Yes, I will use the missile. Yes, I will use the Tomahawks. Yes, I will send people to war. Behind the scenes, things that we don't really read a lot in the paper, he's been sending more troops to Iraq. So, it seems like he's already becoming or getting ready to be grasped by the military-industrial complex. He's not saying it with a whole lot of pizzazz. In fact, in his weekly broadcast, he didn't even mention Syria today. Think about that. He just had one of his major victories by blowing up something in Syria. And he didn't mention it in his weekly address. He didn't mention about these things. Folks, think about it. We don't have a lot of facts to go on right now. We don't. I'm sorry about that. I'm generally a factful person. But what I'm asking folks to do is to infer. And your inference could be wrong. My inference could be wrong. But we must infer so that we are not just used by Trump, the media, etc. So again, The reason I gave it the title of the show today, conspiracy theory, maybe, but maybe not. But we have in a time when we don't have facts, and in a time where people are sent to die, in a time where we're blowing things up, we have to look at all the different avenues and possibilities where facts are not quite available. Anyhow, repeating, establishment Democrats and establishment Republicans agree on very little. The one thing they always seem to agree on is stuffing the coffers of the military-industrial complex and the media, just like the run-up to Iraq, or simply singing the tune of the warmongering plutocrats without doing any logical examination of what is likely occurring. Folks, every Trump voter was deceived. Let me be fair here. The action would not have been a shock for those who voted for, or rather, this action, meaning the attack on Syria, would not have been a shock for those who voted for Hillary Clinton. And by the way, though, I don't even think they would have used the gas if Hillary Clinton was president. Everyone knows she is a hawk, but one with a heart to support the poor and middle class. She would have gotten the same flaming pushback if and when she would have launched an attack like this. But those who voted for Trump, whether they liked him or not, did so because they wanted a president who they thought would fix their problems before creating more international problems that forced him to take his eye off of the ball. Folks, to date, the plutocratic military-industrial complex-driven presidency reigns. We are continuing with our plutocratic presidency. And there are times when, I'm coming to you, John, on the phone in a little bit. There are times when many folks have said, why didn't Obama do X? Why did Obama do Z? Why did Obama send in drones and all these other issues? And one of the things that I told people all of the times is we have to be careful in the manner in which we judge. Because there is something known as the president, and there is something known as the presidency. And the presidency has a lot more gravity, a lot more gravitas than the president, proper. What that means is there's just so much that the president can do, and there's just so much that the president cannot do. There's just so much that the military-industrial complex, along with the plutocracy and the political-driven, the folks driven, the politicians driven by the plutocracy, can do. And that is where you come in. There's a hell of a lot more of us than there are of the plutocracy, than there are of the military-industrial complex. And even those folks in the military themselves, even those people in, Rebecca, who should we push to look into this? We are all looking into it, I tell you that. We need to push. Rachel, I'm pretty sure, is going to be doing some work in there. And there are two investigative journalists from both Newsweek and I think it's the Washington Post that I guarantee you they're doing some digging right now. But this is where we as humans and average American citizens come in. We have to do our job. We have to do our job by putting these messages out. Even this video, one of the things I try to be all of the time is factual, and if not factual because I don't have the information to be fact-based, is to let you know that I'm going off of inferences and conjecture. And with the expectation that you put it out there and folks do some research based on calculated inferences. Not just pulling stuff out of the air, but looking at how things are going and then being able to refute or otherwise. I mean, that's what's done in a court of law, right? I mean, they always try to look for exactly what could cause some particular type of behavior to cause for someone to effect some sort of a crime. In the time of Trump, where we don't have control of the executive, and when we have no control of the legislative body, where they act at will, they act to cover, we are going to have to do certain things by inferring, by doing what we call reductio al absurdum. In other words, keep reducing different aspects of things until nothing else makes sense. Reductio al absurdum. You get rid of all the absurd and then you can come to a logical conclusion. Folks, the telephone number is 62... I forgot my number. Let me get my number for you. The telephone number is 646-929-2495. Again, that number is 646-929-2495. Give us a call. We'd love to hear from you. And right now, I think I have our good friend of the show, Senor John. Come on in, John.
Good afternoon, Igbata. How you doing?
I'm doing fine, sir. Talk to me.
All right. To me, the biggest issue right now is what's Trump going to do from now on?
Okay.
Because, you know, he really, I mean, you're right in the fact that, you know, he really didn't do
anything.
A lot of damage. I know that 9 people did die, supposedly, according to the Syrian government, and there were 4 military people, according to the Russians. Now, whether you can believe them or not is another question.
Right.
But, you know, the real question is, you know, is he going to continue this? And, or is he going to, I mean, because essentially Assad is not stopping anything. He's actually having these, you know, people are taking off from the same airport.
Oh, yes.
And he's continuing his bombing. So I don't see, you know, I don't see anybody, I don't see the Russians stopping. I don't see Assad stopping. So, you know, how is Trump going to, is he just going to, is this going to be a one-off? Or is he going to really, you know, start bombing more and try to, I mean, I think it would be absolutely insane.
Well, you know
To try to do a regime change.
Let me tell you what's interesting. He has no interest in regime change, right? And not only that, like I said, is there proof this reeks of wag the dog? You're correct about that, Timothy Kurtz, and that's why I think the video that I have has the thing of Lawrence O'Donnell saying, wag the dog. But here's the thing. I think Trump had a huge success this week. And when I say a huge success, I can tell you how huge it was. Because what he showed is that he has the ability to change the narrative more so than with his Twitter account, all right? Yes, his Twitter account, we laugh at it, and even the media kind of laugh at it now, but it still takes up some of the news cycle, but it's taken with a grain of salt. When he spent that $100 million or so to send those 59 missiles into Syria, his payback was so much larger. I mean, he got praises from Democrats and Republicans. He got praises, he was compared to Donald Trump. I mean, not Donald. He was compared to Ronald Reagan. He was, it was said that, you know, he had the heart of Ronald Reagan now, and he's a thinking man. He was called intelligent for once. He was told that, you know, he has a vision. All he did was send missiles that some hit their targets, some didn't, and the targets that were chosen did very little damage. And for that, he became the president, like Van Jones erroneously told him a few months ago. And again now, he became the president. He did something great. Imagine, helping people don't make you presidential. Dropping bombs apparently makes you quite presidential. So, I mean, Timothy says, Assad's history of dabbling in chemical weapons has allowed himself to be set up as a stooge or a patsy for the latest alleged atrocity. That is prescient, Timothy. You are absolutely right, Timothy. And that is my fear. Because he had a proclivity for using chemical weapons, that is Assad. Anybody who wants Assad to be attacked simply needs to do the same. But it's not only everybody. It's also giving the cover to Trump. Because, like I said, there's still a possibility that Assad dropped the chemical weapons, but I think it could also be at the behest of Russia, because they know the only way that Trump could get involved in Syria after the week before saying he would not would be to do something dramatic. And there are some benefits in going after Syria, tacitly at least, even if not with a whole lot of effort, because it gives Trump the plausible deniability of being a Russian stooge. I mean, it was perfect. And it's funny, after I wrote this, I think, when was the attack? I think on Wednesday. I think I wrote this on Thursday or whenever, the day after the attack. And Lawrence O'Donnell came out with a great piece. I blogged it on Daily Coast. It's number one on Daily Coast right now. And one of the interesting thing about it is some of the people that are commenting on Daily Coast are complaining about it being conspiracy theories. Lawrence O'Donnell didn't say that this is exactly what happened. He said that because of who we have as a president today, somebody that cannot be trusted, somebody whose definition of the truth is a lie, it was worth examining the plausible alternatives to what really occurred, as long as those of us who are fact-based, let it be known that we don't have facts because we can't get facts. So what we do is we create different possibilities and then see if these possibilities line up. It's like how some people are some diseases are fought. We don't know how the disease is formed. We don't know how the chemical reaction to the disease is. But we remember our grandmother said that if you drank chicken soup, it helped the cold. So we know that is a reality. Now we try to find the mechanics. We know Trump is a liar. Now we try to find if every action that he takes is based on a lie or a truth. John.
Well, I mean, the things that I have a little bit of a hard time with is from your theory, is that, I mean, supposedly the gas, and this has been confirmed by people who were sent to Turkey who were being treated.
Right.
This was a sarin gas attack.
I agree with that, yes.
Chlorine gas attacks, and to be, you know, there have been chlorine gas attacks recently. I mean, in the last month of Obama's, when he was still in office in Syria.
Right.
And so, you know, the chlorine gas attacks, those could plausibly be done by the rebels, because it's not as hard to do. But a sarin gas attack, you know, I think that is much harder to do. And if you look at, you know, when Assad was doing the gas attacks in 2013, you know, first there was a lot of denial, and then there was, you know, basically the Russians and the Syrians got together, and supposedly they, you know, eliminated all of these weapons, and there really hasn't been any sarin gas attacks since then, but there have been chlorine attacks, which actually kill very limited
But John, I want to ask you a question. John, I want to ask you a question, because help me out here. First of all, I gave an option as well where I said there would be a reason for Putin to suggest to Assad to use the poison gas, right? My theory, I mean, I had two theories really. One theory is that it was in fact done by Assad. And the second theory is that it was done by folks, the opposition, to force the America in. Either way, the idea was to force the Americans in. My theory on the Assad side is that that Trump needed help. I think we're going to find out that there is really a relationship between Trump and Putin. And I think it runs quite a bit deep when we look at some of the reports by some of our Newsweek guys who found the reports between Trump and the oligarchs out there in Russia. And we all know that the biggest oligarch in Russia is Putin. But I think what we're going to find out is that there is some congeniality there between Trump and Putin, or Trump and the Russian people, Russian government. My theory is that we know Trump needs help out here, because Trump cannot help Russia if it is believed that he's a Russian stooge. But if he fights with Russia, Tillerson can go to Russia eventually over time and get those releases open, the natural, the gas and oil releases that he has out there, opened up without it looking to be some sort of quid pro quo. God, I'm getting tongue-tied. So that is my theory. What do you think about that?
I mean, it's possible. I mean, anything's possible. But, I mean, I think what possibly happened, and I'm not saying this is 100%.
Yeah, we're all speculating here, yeah.
Right, right. But, I mean, I think that the obvious thing to me is actually what happened, which was they received the message saying, you know, 4 or 5 days ago.
Right. Nikki Haley said that wasn't her mention.
Nikki Haley, right, and Tillerson both said the Syrian people will decide that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was a green light, saying, you know, he doesn't really care about this. He's tweeted about all this stuff. And the other, you know, I guess, you know, you're actually putting emphasis that this is a planned out strategy, that this is, you know, Trump is doing something that actually requires thought. And, you know, I guess I'm kind of skeptical about this because I just don't think he's that intelligent. I don't think he can actually do that.
Right.
I think that he actually, when he sent that message,
mm-hmm.
I think that they said, okay, we can actually do this, and he's not going to do anything. And I think that they were actually surprised because he said this the whole time. And look at the way he's talked about the children. Well, I mean, look at all these refugee children
mm-hmm.
that he doesn't care about at all.
And
so,
you know,
the guy is a walking contradiction.
I love that.
Changing his mind about everything.
A walking contradiction. I love that.
So, I mean, I just don't know if he actually. The Russians, actually planned any of this out. I just think that they were surprised by his reaction. And one thing that kind of goes to this theory is that now they're not communicating. You know, they both have their air force there,
mm-hmm.
and you know, to avoid planes being colliding in the air.
Right.
They had this agreement. Where basically they were communicating, doing their own little, air traffic control amongst
right.
each other, okay. And now that's gone, and so there's there's the chance that two planes could collide with each other, And
but
stupid.
They said that's gone. If going back into our conspiracy theory here. I'm going to tell you, I think, I don't think the orchestration began with the gas. I am a little bit further than that. I think the orchestration began when he said, sent his people to say that we are not going to take any issues with Syria. I think that's where it actually began. And I think you believe that as well for a different reason, but I think that's what you believe as well. I think it began when they came straight out and said, well, we are not going to do anything about Syria. But even above that, it makes no sense. While Trump is dumb, Assad isn't. Putin isn't. And I think they knew, I mean, they don't have to use gas. They can do what they've been doing, bombing the place into powder. I mean, it's that's been killing more people than the gas anyway. And all the gas does is it brings international attention. And I don't think that they want international attention. I think they want to wipe out the opposition. And they need to wipe out the opposition because if they lose, the they're dead, right? Because their particular sector, the minority in the country, if I recall correctly, isn't that the case?
Yeah, the Alawites, right.
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 So, they are going to be wiped out, and I think that is their biggest friend. In fact, I think that's why they're fighting so hard, why they're willing to do all these atrocities, because they know that reality, they can't have this minority government, this monarchy, continuing to run the country as it does right now. And I think they know that. In my humble opinion, that is, of course. But so, again, like we're saying here, John, remember, this is a call-in show. You can give us a call at 646-929-2495. Again, that is 646-929-2495 if you'd like to have your piece. We're pretty nice around here, and I'm pretty sure John would love to hear your point of view as well. So, yes, folks, I am not sure. I am, to put it bluntly, I just think that I am lost on this particular issue. That is the reason, when I think it through, it makes no sense. What makes sense to me are one of these two, if you will, conspiracy theories that I've wrote up about, part of which also Senor Lawrence O'Donnell did as well. I think, absent anything else, you know, we really have to look at this seriously. Now, Trump, have you seen the daily poll? I mean, the running poll lately on Trump, whether it has gotten a bump yet? I haven't taken a look at it.
No, it really hasn't. I mean, he's right at 40 today. And so, I mean, it really hasn't. I mean, yeah, there have been some polls where it's gone up maybe a point or two. But, I mean, it hasn't really changed that much.
Okay, I'm surprised.
I just want to comment also, I just agree with you on the idea that the media, I mean, I know I disagree with you on the media sometimes, but
right.
I mean, I do agree with you on the media and their play, the way it's so incredibly, you know, pro-bombing and pro-war, you know, and mm-hmm. It was really sad, you know, I guess on Thursday when they started talking about it. I mean, there's nothing wrong with actually, I guess, talking about this just to get out information.
Right.
But just the angle that it was put out. And then when I was watching Chris Hage, Sam Cedar was on, and basically you had three or four people, you know, then when they had their kind of Brady Bunch boxes.
Right.
You know,
they were in his skin, weren't they?
Right, and he was the only one that was actually saying, you know, this is ridiculous. You know, why are we doing this? There's no point in doing this. And, you know, you had Jennifer Rubin, and you had this other guy from the think tank, Brookings, and you had McFaul. And I'm also surprised that all of the Obama people, you know, who were in the foreign policy, who came out and were basically saying this is a good thing.
John, hold your thought, because I wanted, you said something important. Most of the Obama administration people came out in support. It just shows you the pressure that President Obama wrote. You remember earlier I spoke about the difference between the president and the presidency? It shows you the president, the pressure that President Obama was likely under every single time something occurred to do something militarily. And the fact that he didn't many times, and the fact that he did with the drone wars, etc., proves that he fought the presidency, that President Obama at some time fought the presidency pretty hard. Because the presidency is, as you just stated there, constantly trying to say, let us engage, let us use our military power. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's also disappointing from the Democratic Party. I mean, you not
absolutely.
Only had, you know, Hillary Clinton, you had, you know, Kerry come out, you had Schumer come out, and you had all of, I mean, I was just, like, seeing all these people, you know,
yes.
McCain and all these other congressmen, and, you know, it's like, they have this idea, just like, you know, we're this great superpower, and if things go wrong in the world, we can just set people right. And I'm just
right.
Like, you know, come on, didn't we learn anything from Iraq? Didn't we learn anything? All of these, you know, whatever, you know, 6,000 American troops die, and then we had, you know, all the hundreds of thousands of Iraqis that die. And, you know, I mean, you said it well at the beginning of the program. You know, I'm sympathetic to the people of Syria also. You know, I mean, I want to see them, you know, try to live in peace. And if that takes, you know, breaking the country up into, you know, five parts and to where they live in peace, that's fine. You know, but I mean, let's live in peace and, you know, let's try to stop the war. You know, let's try to stop the violence. Let's, you know, we've evolved into more of an intelligent species to where we shouldn't, you know, be fighting all the time. That's not the way to solve our problems.
You know, you're so right. You're so right, John. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead, sir.
No, but you know, it just seems like, you know, a lot of Democrats, you know, don't seem to realize that. They're just like, oh, we've got this great military, and this is the way we're solving our problems. No, we don't do that. I mean, you know, it's just kind of sad for me, because, you know, I just thought that there would be more politicians that I'm not saying I had great respect for, but I mean, you know, I do agree with them on a lot of points, but on foreign policy, they seem to be in the wrong area, and they're not listening to the base, because I think a lot of base Democrats, you know, who are against the war in Iraq are also against this intervention, because, I mean, what is the point of it? I mean, again, I'd love to see the war in Syria end, but, I mean, it's hard to do that when you have, you know, 10 different factions fighting each other. You've got the Russians there, you've got the Iranians there, and you got, you know, a leader whose father was a dictator. He's a dictator. And it's just like, how do we come to a solution for this? I mean,
John,
it's just an extremely difficult situation.
John, you're so right. And, you know, and there are a lot of times I remember, you notice that I hit up the Democratic Party in all these blogs as well. Because what we have is a democratic establishment, not the party people outside of the establishment, that have just become themselves either Republican light or neocon light. And it is something that we have to fight. You know, I ironically found myself in support of Rand Paul when he came out and talked about, no, you can't do this. Here is the deal. Those of us that are progressives, it is time for us to do the work on the grassroots level. And by the way, as soon as I get off this show today, that's where I'm heading to. I'm heading to Moody Park here in Houston. We're having a Obamacare rally, not a healthcare rally, where we are going to be pushing for Medicare for All and some other issues, but in the short term, to modify Obamacare to support more people, to help more people. So we have a huge rally. Actually, it's happening all over the country, but we have one here in Houston at Moody Park today at 1 o'clock. I guess I'll be an hour late to the rally, but I'll be there. And then tonight, we're going to Cleveland, Texas, where we'll be confronting Dan Patrick and other big hunchos in Texas, in the Texas Republican Party, who are having their Reagan dinner. So we'll be there to tell those people who are attending the Reagan dinner that we want them to continue to support town halls, continue to support Obamacare, and to also listen to their people. And for those here in Texas, we're warning them that Texas is about to flip because of how evil these folks have actually become. And I don't use that word lightly. Our Republican establishment in Texas, and there are exceptions, there are some good Republicans here in Texas, but they have become pretty darn evil. They have lost their sense of morality, and in the process they have been killing people with policy. And we had a big victory in Texas this week when vouchers and voucherization of schools and transferring monies to private schools failed, and not only failed, but failed miserably. So people are starting to listen, and these politicians are having to listen to the people, because you know what? Even Republicans now are jumping on the progressive bandwagon. Locally here, we have a school board election, and I think they're going to be shocked in the Humble Independent School District. My hunch is that they're going to be shocked when they see the results of this election, because a lot of people are starting to see that they've been hoodwinked by the Republican Party specifically, and some of the establishment Democratic Party, who are really nothing but wards of the plutocracy. When I say wards of the plutocracy, those people who are supporting vouchers, why are they supporting vouchers? Because they want to turn every student into a commodity to make money for a few. They want the dollars from the state, your taxpayer dollars, to go into the coffers of a few. And guess who pays for that? You do. How do you pay for that? Lower wages for teachers, profit motives, profit dollars going into the pockets of a few. So that the $8,000 or however thousand dollars that go to each student when having to go to an independent entity, it doesn't, the economy of scales are quite different. So Americans, both for war and all these other issues, are starting to understand the reality that they've been hoodwinked by a political class, a class that is very, very detached from the process, very detached from the people they represent. But you are starting to do the job. These rallies that we are having are not just, these rallies are to show awareness. A lot of people say rallies don't work. Hey, you're right. Rallies in and of themselves do not work. What rallies do is they give notoriety to a particular issue. They let people know that they have alliances. They let people know that they're not alone. When you're sitting down at home, pulling your hair out, in the case of my head, my bald head, pulling my scalp out, you know that you're not alone. You know that there are other people that think like you. That's what the rallies do. And after the rallies, what we do is we engage the folks and the folks of those folks who then engage the politician. The singular reason Obamacare didn't get killed 3 weeks ago, the singular reason was indivisible all throughout the country, our revolution all around the country, and some would say because the Heritage Foundation didn't support it. But I tell you what, the Heritage Foundation, with respect to Paul Ryan and those guys, don't hold much sway as they used to in the past. They hold more sway with the Freedom Caucus, which is all but 40 or so folks. So it is you, the individual citizen out there, who get involved. Even though there are Republicans that are in there wanting to do otherwise, they still, number one, feel they need to get elected because not all of them are going to get that contract with the private industry that's going to send them back to DC to lobby, because many of them don't have the aptitude to be lobbyists. And these companies aren't going to want dead weight on their backs. So they're still going to be listening to their congresspeople. And let me tell you, folks, don't be fooled. The House is in play. The Senate is in play. And why are they in play? Because for once, Americans are able to see over the, I don't recall when we had the last all Republican government, but they are able to see what an all Republican government looks like, what it's intent on doing, and in what they're seeing, they know now that the ones who pay the price of their intransigence, the one who pays the price of their evil, the ones who pay the price of their inability to govern, those are you.
90 seconds.
John, give me a quick closer.
All right. Excellent show. I enjoyed it. As far as the last time they were in power, it was 2005 and 2006,
Right.
and they had a lot of problems back then. Of course, they didn't have the, they changed the, they didn't have the filibuster. I mean, they didn't have 60 votes to pass anything in the Senate, so they didn't have that. But it's just the idea that their
60
agenda
seconds.
is really not what the American public wants.
Right.
They're very good. I said this before. They're very good at negative politicizing, to where they put down people and they can change people's minds by negative means, by name calling, and kind of playing at people's fears. But I mean, when it actually comes to promoting their agenda, the people reject it.
Thank you
And
very
so
much.
that's good to see that. Yeah, that's good to see. And you're right, indivisible's been great.
Thank you very much, John. That's
Let's
where I'm
go from
going.
there.
I'm going to an indivisible rally right now. Folks, thank you so kindly for spending this time with me at Politics Done Right. But please, we have a lot more to do. Share these videos, share the blogs that you see that comes out on this channel, on the Politics Done Right with Egberto Willis channel.
Seconds.
it is important that we get our message out, but it's also important that we grow the base and make sure we get these people out of office. This is Politics Done Right with Egberto Willis. You have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your weekend. Thank you so kindly for having been here.
Welcome to Politics Done Right. I am your host, Egberto Willis. This is the progressive program that will take the mystery out of politics. This is the program that will encourage you to make sure government becomes we the people. Whether you are liberal, conservative, or otherwise, you get to air your point of view. Remember, you can also send me a tweet to EGBERTOWILLIES. That is at Egberto Willis. Let us engage. It is Politics Done Right.
1, 2, 3, 4.